Good evening and welcome to St. Andrew's on our 5 o'clock service this Saturday and the second Sunday at Advent. We'll have our candles...
Second Saturday.
We'll have our candles lit in just a moment. You probably noticed that if you're looking at your bulletins, Russ Link was leading in music this evening, and unfortunately he's not feeling well tonight, and so he called in, and we have our musicians here tonight substituting. So thank you, Lee and Kristin and Scott, of course, for coming tonight and leading in our music. And so that was a really fun song, especially your part, Scott. Took me off guard. So thank you.
I don't want to follow that, but we do have some announcements. Tonight we're going to be continuing again our focus on how we are a welcoming congregation, especially in how we can grow in welcoming people living with disabilities. And so tonight we have a member of our council. I always forget the title of her position. It's like social outreach or outreach ministries or...
Social outreach.
Yeah. So, but Jeannine really has a deep heart for caring for others. And so Jeannine Eddy tonight, she is going to be sharing a temple talk about the work that she does with NAMI, the National Alliance on Mental Illness. And so we have that. We're going to share that in just a few moments this is a passion of hers and an area where she is continuing to lead our congregation. So we'll share that in just a few minutes.
And then following the service, we had a couple things going on, two different Zooms. We have our happy hour Zoom at 6:15, and then at 6:30, we have our SALT group meeting. You want to say more about what they're doing, Pastor Sarah?
Yeah, our SALT youth ministry has been invited to be a part of a larger gathering of youth on Zoom from all the three synods that incorporate California. And so our youth get to be a part of a larger youth group tonight, and then we'll start up again in January. They'll be doing a youth version of the Dialogues on Race series that our adult forum just participated in. So that will start in January. Tonight they're just going to get together, play some games, get to know each other a little bit, and have some fun. And two of our own youth have been selected to be peer leaders for this. It's called hashtag Cali Strong. And two of our youth leaders are going to be a part of the leadership of that and attended a training, and that's Fernanda and Caleb. So we're really excited for our youth to be able to have this opportunity to connect with other youth, other congregations around the West Coast, especially in California. So the first one of those is tonight, and then we're going to pick it back up, like I said, in January with this group. Mm-hmm. So it's going to be really fun.
And then tomorrow we will not have our adult forum. We're postponing our adult forum through the Advent season. We'll start up again in January with a new book discussion as they're making the decisions as the adult forum leaders there. And so we look forward to meeting with you all again in January for that adult forum.
However, next Sunday, not tomorrow, actually in 2 weeks, mm-hmm. on the 20th, we are going to have a special Sunday school lesson specifically for our third graders who are going to hopefully finally get their Bibles. We've been working on that, trying to find a way to get these Bibles to our third graders for that milestone. And we'll be gathering with them on Zoom to have a little third grade Bible party, kind of Sunday school lesson, on December 20th. And that's at that 11:15 time slot after church. So if you have a third grader who... it wants to be a part of that. We have the Bibles. We haven't handed them out yet. We'll be getting them to you soon and then have that time together in a few weeks.
And don't forget to check out that connection card following the service. You can let us know that you worshiped with us via the live stream, and you can fill out that connection card anytime if you're watching the live stream or if you're watching a recording. You can take part in that connection card. The important thing on that connection card this week is our WIN dinner. The WIN dinner pickup dinner is roast.
This is our last one for 2020. Like roast beast? Like in the How the Grinch Stole Christmas?
Yep.
Is that...
Because
you can call it that.
And because it's roast, that means there's no vegan option or vegetarian option.
Yes.
It's roast. We're not substituting some sort of other meat substitute for that. So we apologize. We haven't figured out how to do a roast without including real meat. So anyway, please check out that connection card. And we thank our WIN cooks, Kristin Hetrick, Carla Barry and Lisa Rosero de Mosa for that dinner this week. We look forward to seeing you in the parking lot picking up your food this Wednesday evening.
And that's our last one of these for 2020. And it's been, I think, really fun. It's been a lot of work from our kitchen crew. So we're so grateful that we've been able to have this kind of fun, interactive way to share meals with people.
It has been really, really great. Really, really good. Also, I remind you that there is a pinch of salt with all the announcements that's included with your bulletin. Please look over that. There is a lot going on this month because it is Advent. And although we are not gathering for worship, we're still doing a lot, including midweek Advent worship. We have a family Christmas festival coming up.
Yeah.
We're making plans for that.
And a congregational meeting.
And a congregational. Don't forget that.
Yeah. Those are
if
both
you are
next
a member.
Weekend.
You are invited to, we ask that you be part of that Zoom congregational meeting coming up on the 13th.
Yeah, a week from tomorrow. So just read the announcements because December is just as busy.
And we're also still looking for those pledge cards. So if you did not do your pledge yet, you can still do so. Just filling out that pledge, emailing it to us, or dropping it off. You continue to do that through this month. We're looking forward to receiving those. If you've not received your pledge card or if you lost it or something, please contact us. We would be happy to get those pledge cards to you. So I think that's all our announcements.
All right, so we're going to turn it over now to Jeannine Eddy as she gets...
Oh, wait a minute.
Oh, you want to do the
quilt? Why don't you do the quilt?
I will.
Okay.
This prayer quilt, we have one prayer quilt this evening, is for Heather Baybutt Gash, who lost her special friend, Steve McCollum. So prayers are for peace and comfort for Heather. And so we'll be saying prayers and tying knots in this prayer quilt on your behalf and sharing that with Heather. Okay, so now we will turn it over to Jeannine Eddy, and she's going to share about her work with NAMI and maybe ways that you may be able to be a part of the work that NAMI does helping to heal people living with mental illness and their families.
Hi, my name is Jeannine Eddy, and we have a son that lives with a diagnosis of what is considered a serious mental illness. His illness didn't present in his life until the late teens or early 20s, and when it did, we were faced with some challenges in finding help for him. So I'd like to share with you an organization that has been a valuable resource for us in helping with this challenge. The organization is the National Alliance on Mental Illness, or NAMI. NAMI is the nation's largest grassroots mental health organization that's dedicated to improving the lives of those affected by mental illness and their families. Mental illnesses are disorders of the brain that disrupt a person's thinking, feelings, moods, and the ability to relate to others. These disorders often diminish the capacity for coping with the ordinary demands of life. Mental illness can affect people of any age, race, religion, or income. Often those affected and their families feel very alone in fighting stigma and the challenges of navigating the mental health system. A few staggering statistics that I'd like to share with you from the NAMI website. Each year in the U.S., 1 in 5 adults experience a mental illness, and they range from mild to severe. 1 in 25 adults experience serious mental illness. 50% of all lifetime illness begins by age 14 and 75% by the age of 24. And almost all, or the average delay between the time or the onset of symptoms and treatment is about 11 years. Almost half the people that die by suicide had a diagnosed mental health condition. So as you see, mental illness is prevalent in a large portion of our population. NAMI has been around for over 40 years and has affiliates in almost every U.S. state. NAMI's goal is to support, educate, and advocate for those living with mental illnesses and their families. Our local affiliate, which is NAMI San Diego, has a variety of resources, and I'd like to highlight just a few of those right now. There are family support groups. These groups are for family members of adults 18 or over that live with a mental health and/or substance use challenge. The group is led by trained facilitators in a confidential and empathetic space. There are also family-to-family classes. This is a free 12-week course for the family members of someone living with a mental illness. The class is taught by trained family members with lived experience. The course sets many families on a path from despair to healing and recovery. And this class was super helpful for us. There are peer support groups as well, and these are for those that live with a mental illness. The group is run by people who live with mental illness for other people who live with mental illness. The program also includes NAMI-trained peer facilitators. In this group, people find support for one another and treat each other with respect, understanding, encouragement, and hope. There's also education and advocacy opportunities where you can listen to presentations from psychiatrists and others working in the mental health profession on a variety of subjects. And lastly, I'd like to share something. It's an app that was developed by NAMI called OSCAR, and that stands for Organized Support Companion in an Emergency Situation. This app is free, and it provides useful information on what to do before, during, and after a crisis, and it also highlights local resources. The app also contains substance use disorder information. So I encourage you to call the NAMI San Diego office or visit the website at namisandiego.org and get more information about when these groups and presentations are available. And due to COVID at this time, all of these opportunities are offered via the Zoom platform. Thank you.
All right, and now we'll continue with our call to worship, Prepare the Way.
Thank you.
we've got some candle lighting to do. So we're going to do that while Scott plays a little candle lighting music.
Don't anyone ever tell you being an acolyte isn't important. It's so important. So thank you for. We want you back, acolytes, when the day is near.
I get to be acolyte next.
Okay.
And now we turn to our Advent litany.
The power of dreams lies in waking up. For when we close our eyes,
we can see a better world. When we close our eyes,
we can dream a better dream.
But when we open our eyes,
we begin the work of faith.
The power of worship is the same when we enter the space.
We can see a better world. When we enter this space,
we dream a better dream.
But when we leave this space,
we begin the work of faith.
So come in, dream your dream.
Find hope here, for in this hour,
we will begin the work of faith.
Let it be so.
Amen.
Our song of adoration is "The King Shall Come." Prepare the way of your only Son. By his coming, strengthen us to serve you with purified lives. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Amen.
And now we'll sing our lighting of the Advent candle song, "Hurry, Jesus."
Thank you. The reading is from the 40th chapter of Isaiah. Comfort, O comfort my people, says your God. Speak tenderly to Jerusalem and cry to her that she has served her term, that her penalty is paid, that she has received from the Lord's hand double for all her sins. A voice cries out in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make straight in the desert a highway for our God. Every valley shall be lifted up, and every mountain and hill be made low. The uneven ground shall become level, and the rough places a plain. Then the glory of the Lord shall be revealed, and all people shall see it together, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken. A voice says, cry out. And I said, what shall I cry? All people are grass. Their constancy is like the flower of the field. The grass withers, the flower fades when the breath of the Lord blows upon it. Surely the people are grass, the grass withers, the flower fades, but the word of our God will stand forever. Get you up to a high mountain, O Zion, herald of good tidings. Lift up your voice with strength, O Jerusalem, herald of good tidings. Lift it up, do not fear. Say to the cities of Judah, here is your God. See, the Lord comes with might, and his arm rules for him. His reward is with him, and his recompense before him. He will feed his flock like a shepherd. He will gather the lambs in his arms and carry them in his bosom and gently lead the mother sheep. Word of God, word of life.
We want to welcome you back and thank you, Carol, for reading. I'm doing that reading of Isaiah 40 for us. It's one of my favorites in all of Scripture. We're going to add a little something extra now to the service. Earlier this afternoon, two of our new members who have joined St. Andrew's were able to come and officially be welcomed in a service of welcoming new members. And so we have that video for you today. We're excited to introduce you to James and Judith. James, in particular, has not physically worshiped in this space. He has only been worshiping with us online since the shutdown and wants to be a part of this church and has officially joined, so I think that's kind of a cool story. And then Judith is friends with the Love family, and so that's a pretty neat thing too. And so we want to share this service where we officially welcomed them out in our courtyard this afternoon.
Judith and James wish to join our congregation.
We find our identity and mission in the witness of the first followers of the crucified and resurrected Jesus. The Apostle Paul focused our life together when he wrote to the congregation in Corinth. When anyone is joined to Christ, they are a new being. The old is gone, the new has come. All this is done by God, who through Christ changed us from enemies into friends and gave us the task of making others God's friends also. Our message is that God was making all humankind God's friends through Christ.
Brothers and sisters, our Lord Jesus Christ has made you his friends and brought you to our community of faith. You have shared our life together from God's word. You have learned of his loving purpose for you and for the whole of creation. Therefore, I ask you to join with all of us in confessing your faith. Do you believe in God the Father?
I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth.
Do you believe in God the Son?
I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead.
Do you believe in the Holy Spirit?
I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
To you who are joining, I ask, is it your intention to commit yourselves to remain faithful and to join with this congregation in its mission and ministry? If so, answer, I do with the help of God.
I do with the help of God.
Upon this, your confession and statement of commitment to our shared faith, mission, and ministry, we welcome you into the family of St. Andrew's Lutheran Church. And now I ask all those present here today to join with me as we welcome our new members into our church family.
We welcome you as members of St. Andrew's to join with us as we serve our Lord by being disciples and making disciples.
Amen.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
The Holy Gospel according to St. Mark, the first chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
The beginning of the good news of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. As is written in the prophet Isaiah, "See, I am sending my messenger ahead of you, who will prepare your way. The voice of one crying out in the wilderness, 'Prepare the way of the Lord, make his path straight.'" John the Baptizer appeared in the wilderness proclaiming a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. And people from the whole Judean countryside and all the people of Jerusalem were going out to see him and were baptized by him in the River Jordan, confessing their sins. Now John was clothed with camel's hair with a leather belt around his waist, and he ate locusts and wild honey. And he proclaimed, "The one who is more powerful than I is coming after me. I am not worthy to stoop down and untie the thong of his sandals. I have baptized you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
So this afternoon, we welcome two new members into our congregation, James Joyce and Judith Yeager. Pastor Sarah Zimley, and I led them through the new member service as you just watched it before this reading a moment ago. And it was truly good news to me to have members join our congregation. And it always is, but during this time, it holds a little more for me as they haven't, and we haven't been able to gather together for worship in our buildings here. What is even more extraordinary is that the good news of the gospel continues to spread here by the power of the Holy Spirit and some technology. Today, our text and the prominent character in this text, John the Baptist, could not be further from our modern technology of the 21st century. So did you hear that good news? Have you heard the good news? Gospel of Mark starts off with the announcement of the coming of the good news. He reveals to us the content and the nature of that good news. It is the good news of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. This is what Advent is: the preparation for the coming of Jesus Christ. And this good news is centered in Christ himself. The good news is that Jesus was born in a poor little out in the middle of nowhere village. And today, Christ comes to the gloomy and barren places of our lives. This is what Advent is all about. This is the good news. Jesus was born into poverty in the hills of Judea. It all began in such lowliness and unpretentiousness. And today, Christ comes to those gloomy and barren, lonely places of our lives and brings the light of God's love and God's grace. It was good news for that first century, and it is good news for our 21st century, and more specifically, it is really good news for 2020. This is the peace. This is the hope. This is the joy of the Advent message. Today, the good news of the gospel touches our very hearts and lives with the announcement that God is with us. Jesus walked along the shores of that Sea of Galilee. But the good news is that today he walks our streets and the trails of our neighborhoods. Jesus is with us amid life's stresses and pressure and tension. If we look at the humble setting where this message of good news first appeared, it really did not appear to have much of a chance of thriving or surviving in any way. The birth of Jesus took place in a tiny little country in this world. How could the good news that came to that community ever become good news for all the world today? The good news first appeared to that little Jewish community. But at that time, the Jews were under Roman occupation. And during their entire history, they rarely knew what freedom and independence were. How could this good news that came to those who were so isolated and occupied by a foreign power ever be good news for all the world? The message of the good news of Jesus Christ is one that is about personal relationships. It is about the relationships between humanity and the divine. Jesus met the needs of that first century world. And the good news is that he meets the needs of our world today in 2020. The good news is that Jesus became God and became flesh and walked among us and knows life exactly as we know it. Knows every pain, every tear, every frustration, every aspect of our lives. Emmanuel, truly, God is with us. That is the good news. This good news is grace. God, through grace, has taken the initiative to bring this world back to God. In the birth of Jesus, a relationship between God and humankind was made possible. And it can never be earned, since it is a result of grace. It can only be received. In fact, grace cannot really be described as it can be experienced. It is more, as I learned in seminary, it is more caught than taught. It is defined in the scriptures as steadfast love. Therefore, as steadfast love, it is reliable. It is constant. The very thing that our lives need today is grace. And grace is love in action. That is a good definition of the grace of God. It is love in action. Love in human action. And the Bible clearly outlines that God's relationship with humanity is not based on the fact that we offer something to God, but on the fact that God offers everything to us. God offers love to us not because we're good or great, but simply because our God is love. Advent is the perfect example of grace. The incarnation of Christ focuses in on a single point in a moment in history on what God, through grace, has been doing always and everywhere. The incarnation becomes the essential clue to the interpretation of the whole mission of God to the world. And what surprises us about God's grace is that God took on flesh and dwelled among us. And that is a surprise. that the Son of God was born into an impoverished family, living really on the fringe of poverty and obscurity. And this child God would die in disgrace as a common criminal. That is the surprising way that God, through grace, chose to go about doing this. And the fact that we are always surprised by grace, because it is God's grace. It comes to us on God's terms. Grace is unearned, undeserved goodness of God that is showered upon our lives, blessing upon blessing. And Mark opens his gospel with the declaration, the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ, and here we find God's love in action in the life of Jesus. The entire Bible is a commentary on the grace of God, which seeks to save. Why wasn't Israel given up as a hopeless people? Because of their constant bickering and their criticism and their own failures. And why is it that God has not given up on us with our constant bickering and criticism and cynicism and failure? Because there is nothing in heaven or on earth that is as stubborn and persistent as the grace of God. We are constantly surprised by grace. And grace may be surprising, but grace is always amazing. God comes to us in the most unlikely place. In this poor little town of Bethlehem, this little village. And God comes through the most unlikely people. This young little girl named Mary. God comes to us under the most unlikely circumstances, in the poverty of the Judean hillside. Today, God through Christ comes again to the most surprising way, through the most unlikely people, through the internet and technology, and more importantly, through you and me. God comes to us at the level of our need. Knowing that we cannot go where God is, God comes to us where we are. This is what Mark calls the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Thanks be to God.
Shoulder marching in the street. When you're all alone,
Thank you. I'm going to just take a point of privilege and thank Kristin DuVall for learning that song and singing it with me. It really meant a lot to me. And we hope that the message you received too is that you have a voice. So together we join our voices, confessing our faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Amen.
We do have a few prayer updates. We're asking for prayers of peace and comfort for the family and friends of Walt Hanford. Walt passed away this week from cancer, so we are praying especially for his wife Judy and their daughter Sherry, and also saying prayers of thanksgiving for his life. We're praying for peace and comfort also for Anna and Frank Habetler. Their son Kurt died on Tuesday, November 20th, so giving thanks to God for the life of Kurt. We're also praying for the family and friends of Stan, and I'm not going to say the last name correctly.
Try it. I think you can do it.
Okay. Matizuski, I think. That's Mary Agnes Smith's father, and he passed away also this last week. So giving thanksgiving for his life, and we have another, I know one.
Yeah, we're praying for peace and comfort for Jackie Williams, whose good friend Joyce Worm has entered hospice care, and so we also pray for peace and comfort for Joyce during this time and all of her family.
Let us pray. God of power and might, comfort your people and come quickly to this weary world. Hear our prayers for everyone in need. Faithful God, you teach us to wait for you with faithfulness and patience. Sustain and support us in our doubts and questions. Nurture our faith as we discern and enact your mission. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer. Loving God, you set the stars in the sky and breathe life into the earth. Renew the face of creation, where it is in need of your healing touch. Mend the wounds of environmental damage and restore balance to ecosystems so that all creation can declare your praise. Lord, in your mercy,
steadfast God, we pray that you continue to sustain us in our struggles with COVID-19. We pray for frontline workers, for those who work in the government making decisions, for caregivers, and all those whose lives are affected. We hold in our hearts now a moment of silence as we remember the many who have died as a result of this virus. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer. Leading God, you ask us to make uneven ground smooth. Make even the disparities between your people. Sustain and support people with disabilities of all kinds. Accompany disability advocates who work for a world accessible to all. And teach us to celebrate the great diversity in our midst. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer. Tender God, you know sorrow and joy alike. We pray for those in our families and congregation who are not joyful in this holiday season. Comfort those who grieve. Be a companion to all who are lonely. Tend to those who are sick or struggling with depression. And gather all people in your healing embrace. We offer now the silent prayers of our hearts. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Draw near to us, O God, and receive our prayers for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Share a sign of peace.
The Lord's peace.
Peace be with you all.
Peace. And as we come to our time of offering, just to remind you all that you can continue to give electronically or drop offering envelopes or offerings into our mail slot throughout the week. Also remind you that if you have not filled out the pledge card, you can do so. And if you have not, I saw one person in the chat that needs the pledge card again. You can do it through the chat and ask for request that pledge card or email the office staff or info@St. Andrews to receive that pledge card. And so now we thank you for your generous offerings during this time and for our musical offering from musicians this evening. So for our children's sermon tonight, I'm going to read a little book, and I think what I found important about this book and sharing it is that, I didn't do preschool when I was really little. I started kindergarten at 5, but then I got to teach preschool for 3 years, and so I really got to do preschool for myself. And what I discovered in preschool, preschool is like everything you need to know for the rest of your life, and that's what we all about. Kids learning how to care for one another and learning to communicate and also learning to care for one another. And this book, which is our Archbishop Desmond Tutu wrote this, and the title is God's Dream. And it fits with our theme for Advent, because our theme for Advent this year is Those Who Dream. And so I'm going to read this story to you all. Both children and adults will, I think, enjoy this and enjoy the artwork as well. So, let's see if I can get this right so you guys can see it. Dear child of God, what do you dream about in your loveliest of dreams? Do you dream about flying high or rainbows, reaching across the sky? There's a what? Panda bear? Oh, there is a panda bear there. There's one. There's a dolphin, too. Do you dream about being free to do what your heart desires? Or about being treated like a full person, no matter how young you might be? Do you know what God dreams about? If you close your eyes and look with your heart, I'm sure, dear child, that you will find out. Kind of felt like Dr. Seuss there. God dreams about people sharing. God dreams about people caring. God dreams that we reach out and hold one another's hands and play one another's games and laugh with one another's hearts. But God does not force us to be friends or to love one another. I think somebody's not being nice there. Do you guys see that? Dear child of God, it does happen that we get angry and hurt one another. Soon we start to feel sad and very alone. See the child here feeling alone? And a little dog here looks kind of lonely. Sometimes we cry and God cries with us. And when we say we're sorry and forgive one another, we wipe away our tears and God's tears too. Oh, do you guys see the little pets at the bottom of the page here? Yeah, isn't that sweet? Each of us carries a piece of God's heart within us. And when we love one another, the pieces of God's heart are made whole. This kind of reminds me of when we're doing communion around the altar and we're all holding hands in that big circle. God dreams that every one of us will see that we are all brothers and sisters. Yes, even you and me. Even if we have different mommies and daddies or live in different faraway lands. Even if we speak different languages or have different ways of talking to God. Even if we have different eyes or different skin. Even if you are taller and I am smaller. Even if your nose is little and mine is large. Dear child of God, do you know how to make God's dream come true? It's really quite easy. As easy as sharing. Loving, caring, as easy as holding, playing, laughing, as easy as knowing we are family because we are all God's children. Will you help God's dream come true? Let me tell you a secret. God smiles like a rainbow when you do. You guys see that image? The end. So let us pray. Gracious Lord, we thank you for the many ways we get to share your love with one another. We thank you for our friends and especially our family and our parents who care and love us no matter what. And who continue to care for us as we get older. And we thank you for your love that continues to shower and bless us each and every day of our lives. Amen.
Let us pray. Generous God, you have created all that is, and you provide for us in every season. Bless all that we offer, that through these gifts the world will receive your blessing. In the name of Jesus Emmanuel, we pray. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ. You comforted your people with the promise of the Redeemer, through whom you will also make all things new, in the day when he comes to judge the world in righteousness. And so we remember in the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, and broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat, this is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Lord, remember us in your love and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. We believe that Christ is present and comes to us in ordinary things.
Abundant God, you have done great things for us, and we rejoice in this bread and cup. You give us life forever. In your boundless mercy, strengthen us and open our hearts to the world's needs for the sake of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
So now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord's face shine on you with grace and mercy. May the Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen. Our closing song is "He Came Down."
He came down that he may have died. He came has to be. I'm not going to remember all that. That's too much. Go in peace, you who dream and you who wake up.
Thanks be to God.